Introduction to ThingsLog and ThingsLog IoT platform and mobile app. So ThingsLog, as you know, is a provider of data loggers, but also a platform for device management, configuration, data handling, and integration with other third-party platforms and services. We do consumption monitoring as a service. Our solution is focused on converting existing meters and sensors into a smart IoT devices. We started with water, where we did remote water consumption monitoring on existing meters, leak detection. Also, we were able to do analysis of the water consumption, so to show is the meter the right one for the particular place. We do similar solution for gas. We have a solution for electricity. And since 1 year, we also have a couple of solutions related to sensor monitoring of pressure, humidity, level, vibrations, loudness, CO2, and others. With a few glance, most of our solutions have also such brochures, which you can download from our webpage and where you can get more information about the particular type of solution. In a nutshell, the platform architecture looks like this. So we have a data loggers on the left, meters and sensors. We retrofit the existing meters to their pulse outputs and our data loggers, and the smart meters, we support them directly. They can send data directly to either LoRa, narrowband, or GSM networks, which can go directly to our platform. And the platform itself consists of a web user interface, a couple of databases, and several APIs, so that we can integrate it with either with the mobile applications or third party software or third party platforms, I'll say, which could be useful either for data visualization or data visualization and storage. In more details, we have the logger, so we can interconnect the existing infrastructures. We send the data over the wireless data networks, 2G, narrowband, and LoRaWAN. And we finally either get the data to the user or to a third-party applications. The end users mostly use ThingsLog UI and ThingsLog mobile app. The third parties integrate to the REST API layer. The platform itself performs also device management, so you can provision, configure over the air time synchronization of the devices, can add accounts and do user management, and you can do the data mediation and handling. The focus of our R&D team is to provide easy-to-use mobile apps for the end user, so we have obviously the ThingsLog mobile app, but we also have several others that are dedicated for particular utility companies or let's say communities. And the other key point of what we do and plan to do in the next several months is the integration with the so-called third-party low-coding or no-code visualization platforms. Basically, with time, we understood that we can do all the possible visualizations for all the customers around the world. So it's much easier to give to the customer ability to do the visualization by himself. So currently, we support Grafana, Elasticsearch, or the so-called Elk Stack, Node-RED, and Azure IoT. An interesting topic was how do we achieve multi-tenancy, basically how ThingsLog platform is multi-tenant, how many people can use it simultaneously. As you know, it's a cloud platform. It lives in our own cloud. Also, we have several instances in Azure and in Amazon. At the same time, basically, on each of those instances exist many accounts, where one account is equal to one organization. In each account could be another account or sub-account, users, and devices. Obviously, the parent account is managing the sub-account, and the users themselves could have, basically, you can create an administrator in each sub-account or viewer, basically. Those are the two. We also support other roles, but those are the two key roles that most of the people use. The integration with the third-party systems is achieved through the ThingsWalk REST API. The REST API is public. You can always check its documentation, current state to our Swagger UI. It's pretty rich in abilities. You can create users an account. You can configure devices over it. You can obtain, obviously, the data, statistics. And also, you can add endpoints for the next API that I'll show you, which is the Data Push API. Basically, this API is such that you have to query the data, and ThingsLog will return it to you. Many people still use it, actually, also for data, for obtaining the data, but the Data Push API, the next one, is the one that is really shines for the purpose. It allows the third-party systems to get the data as fast as we get it, basically. So it's pushing the data to them. The data is pushed in JSON format. You can subscribe your endpoint to the other API. And once we get the data, it will go to your endpoint. The data fields that currently we export are the value of the sensor reading, the receiver signal strength, the bit error rate, the battery, sensor index, device number. And you see here one example where you see parts of that JSON. For example, this is the signal strength, this is the bit error ratio, this is the battery in millivolts, and this is the sensor reading. As a demo today, we'll show you a couple of things. First is how to set an account in ThingsLog platform, how to add a device for a user, and how to set up the sensors and the alarms for those devices. My colleague Lugmil will show you ThingsLog mobile app and how basically that information looks there. And finally, we'll show ThingsLog dashboards, or the so-called Grafana. We'll show you the Grafana integration. This is one of the integrations that we currently support. If you have questions, please raise a hand. There is such an option in Zoom, so that I can a little bit later on check and see, and obviously answer. Cool, let's start the demo part. So first, I'll show you, I have two browsers. This is the ThingsLog platform, and this is, let's say, my parent account. So I have created here one account where we basically have a couple of devices. You have all the needed functionality, like the device manager, account, manage account, battery, signal, all that is available. First thing which we will do is to create a sub-account that happens to the manage account. So I'll do ThingsLog demo sub-account 2. License is something that we add from time to time. Basically, the licenses are applied to the parent companies typically, not to the sub-account. So just create the account. When you come here in account, we see that actually our account has been created and we can select it. Once we select it, we can create users inside. So I'll do some user. And the important bit is to check that here the is selected the company name of your SAP account. If you haven't selected the account prior creating the user will be created in the parent account. And we saw several times that people do that mistake. So once we hit here the sign in button, the user will be created. I don't want to save the details. Let me try to go back. Fortunately, it will not let me do so. But I will log in again with my education account. So there is CAPTCHA, obviously, very annoying, but needed for security reasons. And yeah, it's pretty nice. Cool, so we are back to the platform. If once we select the SAP account, we can also link devices. Just to show you, we have two devices here. I will link that one to this SAP account. But first we have to select it. So it has been linked. And now if I go here to devices, we see that in this demo company we have one device. Basically, that's how you, our partners or our bigger customers can manage their own users and their own customers. For the device itself, the data to look nice, we have to do a couple of things. The most important is beside configuration, initial configuration, all that steps that we always do. In customer, we have to put the name, the street. There are some numbers typically associated with the customer if you are a utility, and basically to save the information, this will be visible here in the devices menu. Another important thing is to name our sensors. Basically, they by default they have the name digital sensor or digital sensor 1, digital sensor 2, if it's enabled. So we have to name it more properly. I'll put, let's say, small, or just to autumn it, because that's not a small one. We can put a description, the model, let's say some ITRON, the serial number, the manufacturer, and so on. And very important, put some currency. If you want to see money in the mobile app, you have to put currency and price. I'll put 3 leva, which is kind of how much the water in Sofia costs. So let's check our other device. Let's go actually to the, sorry, not here, but to accounts and exit. And check also this one. So again, I'll put some name. This is a combined water meter, actually. Again, it's good to have the currency. Could be something else, euro, 0.5 euro. And let's save. Okay, so with this, basically the device is configured. Here, if you do readings, you will see what you put. the same thing will be available in Flow. Here we have a nice leak, by the way. You see how actually the data never really comes to zero, unfortunately. Yeah, let's check also the large one. Unfortunately, okay, it doesn't connect or doesn't have any consumption, but still the small one has a leak. I think now I will give the word to Lubomir, who can present our mobile app. Lubo, are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready. I'm sharing my screen right now.
Okay,
so this is our mobile app. I'm about to log in with the same email as on the website demo. Okay, and we are signed in. We can see the sensors from both those devices. We can see the values from today, this week, or this month. We can check out the graphs and see a very similar graph. We can select the time frame here or the dates. We can see the readings from that specific sensor, like all of the functionality for all of the sensors is the same.
Also, if you have an alarm for the period, you will see it. Basically, the alarm icon will change to red. If you go to week, for example, yeah, you see over there days one. Also, if you go to the graph of that meter, basically you can also check the alarm there. So each time you have an alarm, you see it as such a dot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you see the total volume for the period, you see how much money does it cost. Okay, and now I think show our latest feature, which is ability to have multiple languages in the platform. So basically we support now Bulgarian, Dutch, German or Deutsch, Espanol, Ruski and Greek. I think Greek is a very interesting language. Let's show it in how it looks like in Greek. Yeah, so basically here you see that everything has been translated thanks to one of our partners. Of course, if you name in Greek also the sensors in the UI, they will come up here also with Greek names, but currently I name them in English since I don't know Greek. So that's basically the newest features that we come up. We are going more and more international, so we added those 5 languages. Hopefully soon we will add also a couple of more. And now I think I will share now again my screen to show you the Grafana integration. Basically what Lubo show you is how you can log in with the same credentials in the mobile app. In Grafana, Grafana is basically a tool for data visualization. Let me share my screen. Grafana is a platform that you can install in your own premises and get the data from ThingsLog and show it to your customers in the way that you believe you have to do it. Basically, it's a dashboard tool. We also have an instance which we call dashboardsthingslog.com, basically that also our customers can use. So the Grafana have the principle of dashboards. I have a couple of dashboards here. The dashboard can have multiple panels and the dashboard is visible to the people or the teams in certain organizations. So we have organization here. So in that organization, you can add a team and add some users of your Grafana into that team, and also you can restrict the permissions who to see what. The dashboards themselves are pretty flexible, like just maybe to show one how the queries look like. So basically you have a metric which will come up as ThingsLog. You can select certain device number from the devices that you currently have. And you can also select such a tag. We call them tags, but basically a battery, BTO ratio, signal. If it's a LoRa device, those spreading factor and SNR. Also, you can select sensor indexes. Basically, if you want to get the data connected to the first port of the logger, basically that sensor index 2. If you want the second sensor index 1, the analog ports are always on 2 or 3. You can use group buys. Basically, group buy will allow you to group the devices like this. And you can have multiple queries, as many as you want. In this case, it's only one. You can also choose various visualization types. In this case, it's a table, but same thing could be shown as a graph, as a gauge, as a stat, as a bar. I mean, it's very, very flexible. It's a heat map if you wish. Even you can put it on a map. In this case, let's go to the table. What else you can do? Basically, you can add more and more panels. You can import panels. And our suggestion typically is first to import a couple of panels that we all provide. I'll just take one of those. I call it Total Flow. It's a very basic panel that will show the basically the flow of the devices in Grafana. There are variables, and those variables, we provide the most basic variable here, which is called device number. Basically, this will give you the numbers of the devices that your account currently access. In this case, we had actually the issue that I imported a panel or that basically have many devices, but we don't have permission on them, so we didn't see any date. When I update it here, we get just the list of those. The key thing is those tags, this tag command. So we can use our two devices in that variable. And you see basically the idea of the variable is that it sits here on top and you can select it. And basically this will show you the data from your two devices. From our two devices that we have in our account. How the queries look like? In this case, we have actually two water meters, right? Small and big. And basically, here we select the device number as a variable, which is this value. The sensor index, for example, 0 is the first one. And if we go to the next query, we can see that here we select one, which is the second one. And we do one transformation on the data, actually two. And the first one is we do a binary operation called calculation. Basically, we multiply to the K factor so that we get exactly the same graph as in ThingsWalk UI. And then we do total. Basically, we add the water from the two water meters into one total field, basically, which shows the total consumption of this building, basically, this is a large shop. So kind of that's the same thing we do here, but we show it as a table. Very simple, very effective, also very useful. That's how we manage our own customers in Bulgaria. We have dashboards for them in particular, but also we have also the dashboards that we group the data, which our Nokia engineers monitor, and that's how we can react if something happens. Basically, we built our dashboard that suits our needs. I think that was our demo for today. Maybe time for questions. Any questions? I will let anybody talk so that basically we can, you can ask directly. Hello, Chris. How are you?
I'm well. I just unmuted. I didn't have any question, to be honest.
Yeah, I think you know most of that. You passed through much of it.
I
think what you still maybe that you still don't know a couple of things about Grafana, and we recently developed a guide. That actually helps to people like you that are actually know you have nothing to do with programming or you're a water engineer. Basically, we will allow you to build those dashboards by yourselves pretty well.
That's good news.
Yes.
An idea when the document will be available?
It is available. Okay. We still haven't distributed to to the people, but it is available. Yes.
May I also ask what's the time frame for additional languages in the ThingsLog platform?
It's under development. Lubo, who is actually one of our developers, I think we are working on it. It's a little bit more complicated there. That's why we put first the focus on the mobile app.
Yeah, which is great.
And I think in a couple of weeks, hopefully, you will get also the platform in your language.
So if you need any feedback on German, feel free to send over a link. I will go through it and give my best.
Hopefully you will not put some bad words in the translation. Yes, of course, Michael, we will do so. Basically, we will release most likely again as the app demo version or beta version, and we will let you check and see and comment it.
Also, we thank you. It is very appreciated.
Yes.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Thank you, Idia. Do you have any questions?
No, we have a good teacher. No questions.
Yeah. It's a pleasure, actually, for me. Just, you know, water is a new domain for me. I'm not a water engineer. Very far away from the water or from consumption monitoring, but with time, I also learn and share.
So I've done water consumption measurements since 10 years now. And when I look into the platform, I have to say, even if you're not expert, you did a very good job with all the additional things the platform provides, like price and minimum, maximum alerts and measurements, zero consumption measurements. So it's a pretty nice tool.
Yes. I mean, it was a long term actually until we reached to that point. But yeah, initially we didn't understood pretty much anything about water. Yeah. Now with time, with help of people like you, we slowly but surely do it better and better. Hopefully in a year or two it will be on a very different level. But still, I think it works. People use it. Like we saw, I don't know, do you know the history, but long time ago we went to a trial with Sofia Water Company, and we went to a very big guys there, and we beat them.
in that
trial, it appeared that basically, even with that very basic functionality that we provided, it was not easy for the others to do it as well.
Yeah. Yeah, sometimes it's good to come from outside to have a different point of view.
Oh, for sure, yes, exactly. That's why we actually do maybe good, because kind of.
May I also ask a different question, which is related to the webinar we had last week?
Yes.
Was it last week? I think there it was also the topic about GPS. Data recording or something like that with the data loggers.
Yes.
Yeah. So You mentioned there's something in this direction is already possible. Is it something like GSM tracking, or what is currently already working?
I'm not sure. Did I understand you correct? But we have an option which is very popular in Latin America world. Basically, over there is a regulatory requirement to the data logger to keep data from the last 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And in those cases, we add a special EEPROM memory and provide to the user basically a tool, a program, with which basically when you connect to a cable, with a cable to the logger, you can download the data. And once you download it, you can visualize it obviously as a reading, and you can push it to the platform, which is the second nice option, because kind of I don't see a big point just to have the data. It's not very visible. Like data is data, but when you see it that way, you see that it's a leak, you know.
I was asked by a customer, because they are selling products, and the products they are selling, they sometimes want to ensure that the product is used in a certain project to ensure where the devices finally have been delivered to. And that's why I was asking if there is any chance to locate the
That's a different story. No, that's still not available.
That's a different one to have
a GPS inside the device. I think last webinar there was such a discussion. I remember now.
But is it somehow possible to just recognize the GSM?
Yes, it is. If it's signal with our
sector.
If it's with our SIM cards, we know in which kind of network and which kind of a node in the network the device has registered. I don't think that we know the base station, but we know the area, let's say.
Okay. So I will take this as an information and discuss with my contact. Probably, maybe that's already enough. I will check.
Yes, it looks like it's visible when the device travels into the data that we actually get, and you don't currently see or receive.
Yeah.
That the device is registering to a different thing, basically.
Yeah.
Hopefully that will be sufficient.
Yeah, I will check and come back to you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so for today, from my side, no more questions. As it was already mentioned, we have a very good teacher. And looking forward to additional webinars to build up more and more knowledge.
Yeah, I think I promised to myself December to be maybe a quieter month, because there is a lot of also other work, but we can do one. I think I have an idea for to show narrowband IoT technology to you.
Okay.
Which I think will be very interesting, and I just have to prepare myself.
Yeah.
And then we'll see. I mean, if you have an ideas for webinars or maybe some how certain things has to be done or could be done, we can work on it, and please suggest we will do our best. I unfortunately I speak very bad German, and can't do it in German, for example, or in Greek.
It's as long as we both understand English, it's fine.
And also all the other
participants can follow. If we start to talk German, it would be difficult, maybe.
Yeah, but I hope sooner or later I'll be able to make also original webinars.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what we can do next year in December in Salzburg.
Yes. Okay, have a good one. Katya, Ilya, I see also you are still here. Do you have questions? No. Okay, have a good day. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, bye-bye.
Bye.